Let me thank our students, Dr. Srinivas and Dr. Ravi from Vizag, who are awake with me all the way till early morning, 6 o'clock, to recompose this question paper. 250 questions is a humongous task to recollect, and that too with a lot of case study based questions being given in the JIPMA, but still the human brain has billions of neurons, and any amount of recollection, our memory is incomprehensibly high than any other species on this planet. This reason, as many questions as possible we recollected, but still there are 100 more questions which we will post it on the blog. As many we could recollect, we will have a discussion here. So doctor, gray ramae communicans, what is it basically? If you take the spinal cord, it has got one preganglionic sympathetic fibers that pass through white ramae communicans, and the postganglionic sympathetic fibers basically pass through gray ramae communicans, is what you have to basically understand. Now doctor, which is not a tributary of the hepatic portal vein, is the question of JIPMER November 2014. So basically you need to remember that it is the confluence of the splenic and the mesenteric vein. The splenic vein and the mesenteric vein forms the portal vein. That's the reason it is also called mesentrico-splenic vein, is the name which is being given for it. Then in addition to that, cystic vein, gastric vein, there also the other tributaries of the portal vein is what we have to basically remember. What structure does not cross the mesentery? Root of mesentery was a very important question. Basically, if you take the duodenum, the third part and the ascending fourth part, they cross. Abdominal aorta crosses, IVC crosses, right ureter, right psoas, right gonadal vessels. All this basically will pass, is what you need to basically, you need to remember. Where is the deep inguinal ring is present? Where is the superficial inguinal ring is present? Don't you call this as the most high yielding topic? Inguinal canal anatomy is a frequently tested area in the anatomy. Portal vein is also a very high yield topic. Mesentery is another very high yield topic in the topic list given to you. That gray ramae, white ramae only is little two ramus, but that is general knowledge. 10% questions are general knowledge. So basically deep inguinal ring is a layer in the transversalis fascia, and the superficial inguinal ring is the one which is there in the aponeurosis of the external oblique, is what you have to basically remember. Now, what are the branches of the popliteal artery? One arterial branches will be asked, doctor. Generally, aorta, celiac trunk, carotid, internal and external carotid, circle of Willis. Then femoral, popliteal, tibial. One vessel, it is a branch of what? Similarly, stomach blood supply is also the favorite high yield area for the PG medical entrance. So we need to remember genicular branches, anterior tibial, posterior tibial, all of them are branches of the tibial artery. Maybe option D would have been some other femoral artery branch or something like that. So what are the branches of the popliteal artery, doctor? Anterior tibial, posterior tibial, sural, then the medial superior, lateral superior, genicular, and middle lateral inferior genicular. These are all the various branches. When will myelination begin in our fetal life is a very important question. So our guns who have taken the JIPMER exam, they say that 14 weeks was not in the options, but the precise fact is myelination begins at 14th week of fetal development, something which is nearer to the 14th out of this you need to choose, but they are all far from the 14th actually. So maybe the problem is the Jipmer 250 questions in such a short time was like a running race for the students. That's the reason difficult to remember and recall the options. But this question, I don't think anybody would have answered. If you didn't answer, no regrets. Because there are so many things. When will the tail begin? When will the tail is gone? When will the fetal eyes will be open? Who will remember all those things? Huh? So, one, give it to God. But this, don't give it to God. This must be in your control, doctor. Azygous lobe, kaha dikhai dega aapko? So, typically it is the right upper lobe is the classical location where you find the presence of azygous lobe is what you have to basically remember. Why the adduction of the wrist is more than the abduction? Ye bhi kuch padke answer karne wala question nahi hai. Common sense ka istemal karke answer karne wala MCQ hota hai. So if you don't carry your common sense, there is a bigger damage. So that's the reason, doctor. Radial styloid is lower than the ulnar styloid. And that is the main reason. Adduction of the wrist is more than the abduction is what you have to basically remember. Right? So Sai 324 is saying 20th week is there in the options. You wrote Jipmer? Okay. So then that should be called as the closest answer. Right, doctor? Then, I am very happy to see 45 plus online viewers who are equally awake for the past 48 hours to recall the paper and bring it before you. And let me tell you, doctor, there will be lot of similarities of the questions that are going to come in DNB, All India, AIMS, the next state entrances everywhere. That's the reason you should you should have a clear introspection of what were the questions, how did we answer. That really do help. This is the beautiful question I am waiting since long period of time to come in the PG medical entrance. What is the level of the facial nerve lesion? If the lacrimation is intact, but there is a loss of the taste in the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, is one of the very, very important MCQ. So, facial nerve paralysis in the anatomy is the highest, one of the top high-yield topics in the top 20 topics which we mentioned in the newsformedico.com webpage, 1131 high-yield topic list. Okay, you can also download it from the download section. So doctor, basically where is the facial nerve nucleus located? Pons. Any pontine lesion, if it is there, it will also involve the other cranial nerve nuclei in the brainstem. That is the in the pons. So what are other cranial nerve nuclei? Abducens can be involved, so there is a development of loss of abduction leading to medial movement of the eye leading to strabismus, facial palsy, and your corticospinal tract is descending through the brainstem. So any pontine lesion will affect it. That's the reason contralateral hemiplegia will be there. Then trigeminal nerve is typically located in 5th, 6th, 7th are in pons. That's the reason there is a facial sensory loss, ipsilateral facial sensory loss. That is what you will come across. Then from the pons, where will the facial nerve pass into? It will pass into cerebellopontine angle. This is the place where you can have an acoustic neuroma that will lead to associated eighth nerve loss and all components of the facial nerve. That is loss of anterior two-thirds taste sensation, loss of lacrimation, which are both due to the branches coming out, caudate tympani coming out of facial nerve, and lacrimation because the petrosal nerve which is coming out of facial nerve, that also get injured. Along with that, all motor supply of the face that also will undergo paralysis. Complete paralysis will be there if it is cerebellopontine angle. Then the facial nerve enters into facial canal. When it enters into facial canal, what do you have? You have a inner ears, inner auditory meatus. Right? So, internal auditory meatus and geniculate ganglion. Between the two, if it is involved, then there is a loss of anterior two-thirds of the tongue. Caudate tympani is given at that point. And also there is a loss of lacrimation because petrosal nerve also going to the lacrimal is also given at that point, along with facial nerve palsy. But if at all it is involving at the geniculate ganglion, generally it is due to herpes. That's the reason you find herpetic vesicles in the external ear. There is a loss of taste in the anterior two-third, also loss of the lacrimation and also facial nerve palsy. But from geniculate ganglion, it will be traveling through to the stylomastoid foramen. When it is traveling to the stylomastoid foramen, typically it passes a horizontal course, a vertically downward course, and then it will come out of stylomastoid foramen. So there is a loss of anterior two-thirds of the tongue because still caudate tympani is coming out of it. But lacrimation will be intact. Here lacrimation is not affected because the petrosal nerve which is supplying the motor supply to the lacrimal gland already originated above the level of the geniculate ganglion. That's the reason lacrimation is intact and there is a facial palsy. Suppose if it is coming out of the styloid foramen and involves, then what are the branches of facial nerve? Buccal, zygomatic, temporal, cervical, mandibular, right? TVZMC, temporal, buccal, mandibular, zygomatic, cervical. All the branches typically become involved. Then it becomes like a LMN type of a paralysis of the facial nerve. So, what is the conclusion? It is between geniculate ganglion and stylomastoid foramen when that horizontal portion is involved, then there is no loss of lacrimation, only loss of taste along with the facial nerve palsy is what you have to typically remember, doctor. Now, let's go to this is an interesting question. So, similar question can come, examiner can ask that, there is a herpetic vesicle, what do you expect? Do you expect loss of lacrimation or not? That is what we are expecting in the DNB and the All India exam, which is going to come in a short period of time. So I leave all this literature for you, doctor. Now, compression of the hook of the hamate with a hyperextended hand, what does it lead to? The damage to what does it lead to? Right? Yeah. Very good. Some of our online students are giving very good value addition with their comments. We will go through one after the other comment towards the end of the discussion. Just ask him to keep a copy of this additional options given everything. Let him keep a copy in the Word document. The chat copy. Now, doctor. If you take ulnar nerve has got one dorsal sensory branch. Typically it will supply the dorsal ulnar aspect of the hand and the ulnar 1.5 fingers. Then once it enters into Guyen's canal, it will be giving rise to two branches. One is called superficial cutaneous branch of the ulnar, other is called deep motor branch, which passes very close to the hook of hamate. There's a reason any hook of the hamate injury will affect the deep motor branch of the ulnar nerve. It is called a cyclis injury is what you get. Similarly, any Guyen's canal compression neuropathy. So what is the very high yield topic in entrance exam? Definitely every entrance may one question will be there. About what? ulnar nerve, median nerve, radial nerve, axillary nerve, musculocutaneous nerve. Life must be these five important nerves of the upper limb. Then sciatic nerve, sural nerve, popliteal nerve, tibial nerve. So they are the main things in the lower limb. Totally 10 peripheral nerves of lumbosacral and brachial plexus. Now doctor, pointing index is because of what? You see, not one question, two questions, brachial plexus definitely will be A. So similarly, what is meant by sign of benediction? What is meant by ulnar paradox? What is the difference between a high ulnar and low ulnar injury? Then what is meant by Frohman sign? All these things, you must go to the exam with confidence. Definitely, they are the ones you can bag any exam you go. Right? Now doctor, superficial branch of radial nerve is there in the options. Yeah, whatever, but ultimate idea of the examiner was what is that branch which is affected in the hook of Hammett. Now doctor, index finger, pointing index finger, anterior internosseous branch of the median nerve is what you need to remember. So now tell me, out of this 11 questions in anatomy, how many do you like to get? You can easily get 8 out of this 11. 3 questions can be slight bounces. Any, however be the paper doctor, proper generally scores 75% is the rule, if no negative marking. Any, whatever be the degree of toughness of exam, proper scores 80 to 85% if it is no negative marking. Simple rule of the game. And generally 10% marks. Suppose if topper got 170, 10% is 15 marks. Up to 15 marks you have a way to walk in. If you are not within that 15 marks, you are out. So that means 170 if the top mark, 155 should be in open competition. So N-acetylcysteine replenishes what? Typically it is the glutathione which it will be replenishing, which is a natural antioxidant which is available, is what need to be remembered. Can you close the door? Now, what is the drug interaction between lithium and hydrochlorothiazide? What is our fundamental agreement before you have gone to exam? Lithium, digoxin, tricyclic antidepressants, migraine drugs, epileptic drugs, TB drugs, antibiotics and their mechanism of action. Only 10-15 things I want you to read when you go to the exam, right? So anything, everything about lithium, imidazolam is another very favorite drug. Adenosine is another drug. Definitely one or the other question will be asked. So what is the question? What are the drug interactions? I have altered the questions, but actually I don't know whether the other three are the same options or not. But the blood levels of the lithium rise. So what lead to lithium toxicity? This you would have otherwise also easily guessed. How? Examiner will definitely ask a question on lithium. Examiner will ask a question on lithium toxicity only, no? There is nothing like, it is not like oral contraceptive pill. Oral contraceptive pill mein OCP failure ke upar question ho sakta. Lithium failure ke upar kyo hota? Nahi hota. Lithium toxicity ke upar question hota. Isliye lithium toxicity is what? Increase in lithium levels. Finish. So you know the 1131 topic list you can answer. So cirrhosis, nephrotic syndrome, diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus, anything which decreases the circulating volume of plasma can lead to lithium toxicity. Similarly, ACE inhibitors, cyclosporine, tetracyclines, NSAIDs, anything can be responsible. Renal insufficiency, should not forget. Similarly, what drugs typically will lead to increased, decreased and no effect on the lithium concentration? I leave the literature for you. Now, doctors. Alendronate. First of all, who asked your examiner to give this question? Is it the part of the mafia plan or no mafia plan? You take last 5 aims exams. One question on the osteoporosis drugs. One other question, the osteoporosis ka drugs right then? Definitely will be asked. How is alendronate different from the other biphosphonates? How biphosphonates differ from the other drugs which are given in osteoporosis? Everything you should know. So alendronate inhibits the osteoclast mediated bone resorption is what you need to basically remember. What is the deal? One question on diabetic drugs. Aapne PGA November dekha, AIMS November dekha. Koi insulin ke bare mein puchega aur koi sulfonyl ureas ke bare mein puchega aur koi biguanide ke bare mein puchega. Agar aap diabetic drugs nahi padke gaye to I am failing in my job to inspire you to read. Okay, doctor. So, doctor, metformin inhibits the gluconeogenesis and also metformin increases the peripheral receptor sensitivity to insulin. But it is not an insulin secretagogue. That's the reason it is a euglycemic but not a hypoglycemic drug is what you need to basically remember. One HIV drug. Without that, where is the question paper? Very calculated paper, doctor. Who said it is tough? Yeah, 30-40 questions may be tough. But tough for everyone equally. But ise nahi chodna. Nahi chodna. So, N-fluvartide is basically a fusion inhibitor. You take APPG or any entrance, every time one HIV drug will come. One Parkinsonism drug will come. So fusion is FU, N-fluvartide has FU. And FU is also there in 4. That's the reason you can remember GP41 inhibition. It will bind with GP41. 4 is fusion, 4 is N-fluvartide, 4 is 41 is what you have to basically remember. Then Maraviroc. You can remember, you rock when you are 5, you rock when you are 12, and when you are 20. So it binds to CCR5, inhibiting the interaction with GP120 is the mechanism of Maraviroc is what need to be remembered. Then what are integrase inhibitors? That is the question straight going to come in the next DNBCET. You can remember Raltegravir, it also has got Integra inside it. It inhibits the HIV integrase. Then, what are nucleoside and non-nucleoside inhibitors? Is an important question. Have you dined with my nuclear family? Dine is zidovudine. And it is a nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. Then, never T is a protease. Protease. So drugs that end with navir, all navirs, most of the navirs are all protease inhibitors, etc., etc. Alright. Now, which will not cause drug-induced hepatitis? This is one of the oldest question on the planet Earth. Ethambutol is the liver-friendly anti-tubercular drug, as all of you know very well. Isoniazid, pyrazinamide, sulfonamides, ketoconazole, methyldopa, phenytoin, they are all the classical drugs you will not forget which lead to development of drug-induced hepatitis is what you need to remember. This is an unexpected question. To prevent unexpected pregnancy, if the husband is taking methotrexate and wife is taking OCPs, now they want to conceive. I am not talking about the wife taking methotrexate. Husband had rheumatoid arthritis and taking OCP. He is taking methotrexate. Whether husband takes or wife takes while taking, if they conceive, couple, then the teratogenic effects will fall. That's the reason husband should stop methotrexate for at least 3 months. And during that time, there should be OCP coverage in the wife. And after that, तीन महीने के बाद उसका इफेक्ट बदन के ऊपर जो भी है वो चले जाएगा, तब तक आप रूमेटॉइड आर्थराइटिस को भी कंट्रोल करना पड़ता, एंड देन दे नीड टू गो अहेड विथ कंसेप्शन. दिस इफ यू डिड नॉट आंसर नो प्रॉब्लम, प्योरली गेस. यू मस्ट नो द रिकमेंडेशन टू आंसर दिस, बट अर्लियर क्वेश्चन आर ऑल स्टैंडर्डाइज्ड क्वेश्चंस बेसिकली. नाउ डॉक्टर, when you are on isotretinoin therapy for acne, what do you want to basically check? This is a standard question. Lipid profile you need to basically monitor. I wonder, liver function tests were also given, I believe, but isotretinoin also need to be carefully given those who are having a liver dysfunction. But normal aadmi mein agar isotretinoin de rahe to, you should always evaluate their lipid profile regularly. At low dose, there is a linear increase in plasma drug concentration, and at high dose, there is a steep increase in the drug concentration. That means the metabolizing enzymes got saturated once drug reached a particular level. There is a reason from that point, there is an exponential rise of the concentration. Right? So, such a thing is called saturation kinetics. Saturation kinetics is synonymous with zero order kinetics. So, some of the students have given that zero order was also given. I don't think they would have given. So, it should be saturation kinetics, first order, pseudo zero order. I don't know whether it is given or not. But this is an example of a saturation kinetics which is synonymous with zero order kinetics. Now, regarding the various antidotes, beautiful question. Generally, our tendency will be what? Ethanol is for methanol toxicity, right? So, basically, you need to remember, if you take ethanol and isopropyl alcohol, they have no specific antidote. Whereas, ethanol and fomepizole, which is a alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor, they are the ones for ethylene glycol and methanol poisoning they are given, not for isopropyl alcohol poisoning. That's the reason isopropyl alcohol poisoning agar ho gaya to, it is a white colored liquid and it is a very sweet smelling one. There is a high propensity for ingestion of isopropyl alcohol. So, we generally do hemodialysis. That's the point. For cyanide, we use methylene blue, N-acetylcysteine for paraquat, right? Then oxymes for the organophosphate poisoning and insect naru gas poison like serin. We use the oxymes. That's the point. Okay, doc. Then lenalidomide co-administration with what will lead to DVT? This is a pure old question. If you answered previous JIPMER or previous AIMS questions, you will remember it. So, it is the, sorry, it is not C, it is B, a correction. So, it is the dexamethasone plus lenalidomide. Generally, there is a tendency to give both of them in multiple myeloma management. Whenever you give, there is always a risk of deep vein thrombosis is what need to be remembered. I think Vizag is saying correct match is asked, not the mismatch. But serine and oxime are well matched. Is it there in the options? We don't know. We don't remember. Except is there or correct is? Correctly matched is there. Okay. I mean, the idea of a postmortem discussion like this is, what is the most appropriate answer and what is our next strategy if we didn't get the seat for our future exam in view of this kind of a question paper. That's the whole idea. MRSA avoid karne ke liye, what's the best measure? Washing the hands is the most simple answer. One toxin, doctor, before the exam only it is our agreement that we have to read one toxin. diphtheria toxin, cholera toxin, botulinum toxin, etc., etc. So, it is the adenylate cyclase and cyclic AMP elevation is what you see whenever the cholera toxin is basically acting, is what need to be remembered. And typically it will lead to the ADP ribosylation of the factor 6, which in turn will lead to the development of activation of the adenylate cyclase, is what need to be remembered. हमने एम्स देखा, पीजीआई देखा और रिसेंटली बिहार पीजी मैट 2014. जूनोसिस इज अ फेवरेट क्वेश्चन डॉक्टर. देयर टू थिंग्स यू हैव टू रिमेंबर इन एसपीएम. वन क्वेश्चन ऑन साइक्लो डेवलपमेंटल, साइक्लो प्रोपगेटिव, व्हिच टाइप, दैट इज जनरली आस्क्ड विदाउट एनी शेकिंग, यू नीड टू आंसर इट. जूनोसिस के ऊपर एक क्वेश्चन आएगा और अगर कुछ कैलामिटी, कैटास्ट्रोफ हो गया, अर्थक्वेक हो गया, फ्लड्स हो गया, देन व्हिच इंपॉर्टेंट इंफेक्शंस एपिडेमिक्स बिकम प्रिवेलेंट, दैट इज अनदर फेवरेट एमसीक्यू इन द एग्जामिनर्स क्वेश्चन बैंक. सो डॉक्टर, बेसिकली व्हाट इज मेंट बाय, व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ जूनोसिस? यू हैव डायरेक्ट जूनोसिस वेयर इंफेक्टेड वर्टिब्रेट होस्ट टू ससेप्टेबल वर्टिब्रेट होस्ट बाय डायरेक्ट कॉन्टैक्ट. Cyclozoonosis require more than one vertebrate host but no invertebrate host. Metazoonosis means they will multiply, develop, or both in a invertebrate host before they transmit to the vertebrate host. Plague, arbovirus, schistosomiasis are the classical examples of metazoonosis, is what you need to basically remember. Now doctor, Neisseria and all capsulated organism infections, it is because of the terminal complement component pathway deficiency, which typically occur in the people who are splenectomized or those who are having autosplenectomy, etc., etc., is what need to be remembered. This is a standard question. Iske pehle metazoonosis wala question hai na, or agar aap very obsessive preparing aspirant hai to answer kar sakte. Not for the weak hearted का answer करने वाला question नहीं है वो. Who will remember the definition on so into the depth of zoonosis? But it is not at the same time very unpredictable part, because zoonosis is a high yield topic in the 1132 topic list. That's reason you need to master it. There are various versions about this question. As to respiratory viral infections, may what are the various methods used, or all methods are used except, and similarly options also, there were various opinions about the answers, options. But one point I want to tell you, respiratory viral infections, you can use any of these methods, but generally it is the nucleic acid amplification which is considered to be PCR. If that is there in the option, that becomes the best test. Otherwise, you can use immunofluorescence, which is also equally good. ELISA is also available for you to do. So, there is a small variation here and there. Anyway, I leave the literature about how do you diagnose respiratory viruses. Then once more, doctor, Ebola, don't forget, that is going to come in DNB and All India and state entrance exam, because that is the most current topic which you need to be very sure. So we will host 10 points you need to remember about Ebola for MD entrance on the newsformedico.com. You can keep in touch. If your email ID is not included, please do a self-registration, free registration into the newsformedico.com. We will be sending you a newsletter on the recent updates, suggested topics for the MD entrance, etc. Directly you can open it in the mobile. Now doctor, itna pre-transfusion testing karne ke bawajood post-transfusion hepatitis ka prevalence kyon bahut bada hai, is a very important debate across the hematology circles. But what is the most common cause of the post-transfusion hepatitis? Once more, hepatitis B only. It is not hepatitis C, or it is not CMV. CMV generally get transmitted with the WBCs. the belly basis. If it is an immunocompetent guy, it won't lead to hepatitis. Only immunocompromised people only it lead to hepatitis. That's the reason generally we don't do screening for CMV. Coming to hepatitis C, we do anti-HCV screening. That is not an issue. But the problem is, if you take hepatitis B, people can exist in a window period. During that time, neither the surface antigen nor the antibody, neither of them are present in their serum. That time, if you have thought it as he is negative, but actually he is positive, and you are transfusing such a blood. That's the reason, doctor, as a consultant, unless it is a very daring indication, don't attempt to using transfusion as an option to treat the patient. That's the point. What is our deal in microbiology? First topic I want all of you to read in the high yield topic list, any entrance you go, streptococci, staphylococci, culture characters, novobiosin sensitivity, bile solubility, optogen sensitivity, catalase, coagulase, how do you differentiate, alpha kya hota, beta kya hota, wo sab, gram positive organisms you have to. So Dr. Staph aureus if you take is catalase positive. It is the catalase activity which will enable us to distinguish between staphylococci from that of the enterococci and streptococci. Entero and strepto are negative for catalase activity. Is what need to be remembered. A diabetic is having cellulitis. Generally, if you take cellulitis, what is the most common cause of the cellulitis, doctor? Staphylococcus. Not strepto. Staphylo followed by strepto. But diabetic individuals low, specifically, you need to remember Pseudomonas has a special predilection for the diabetic individuals. How is the resistance to Streptococcus pneumonia most commonly acquired? The word is most commonly acquired, right? Is it the same question? It is the, what is your answer? Guess Maro. Let me see what is our online students' answers. I am very happy to see 53 plus online viewers. Very good. Yes, doctor. So the entire night up to morning 7 o'clock when sunrise was there to wait, and still some more questions we are pushing, but we thought we worked till the maximum end of this thing. But it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. People after getting seat in MD, they don't read like this, but you are giving me a chance to study along with you like a young student. But Jipmer doctor, wow, the breeze from the sea in the evening, Nera Pondi, the people who invite you to have every day is a vacation in Pondicherry, and eating the cone of ice cream on the beach side, and beer is very, you can like water, you can get it dutyless. At least going to Pondicherry for taking entrance is to have a booze. So then doing a night duty and walking to the gate and eating in the Babai Hotel, the paratha, going to Indian coffee house and having coffee in the Pondi city. Oh, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. Life will not come back. If I meet my Jipmer friends who are top surgeons, the word of Jipmer make them, oh, let's leave all these things and go back to Pondicherry kind of a feeling. So, of course, that pleasure will come in any place where we do post-graduation, right? It's like our birthplace, where first time we did hernia or refi, first time you have done hysterectomy. So you can never forget it. So have a positive spirit. Shortly by April, you will be called PG, postgraduate, and you are running here and there with a blood bag or a laboratory report. or you are going and swabbing hands to take the first chance to operate. So the life is going to be different, right? So so what is your answer, doctor? Raj, Vengalrao, Srinivas, Krishna, Lucky, Shah's meta-analysis, Balina, everyone is proposing altered penicillin binding protein is the most common mechanism. Exo versus endotoxin is the age-old MCQ. Any entrance you go. So doctor, if you look at the heat stability of exo versus endotoxin, exotoxins are heat labile and endotoxins are heat stable is what you have to basically remember. Oh, this is the 8th class biology question. 5 liters is the per minute cardiac output, blood volume, and 72 is the rate. If you know 5000 ml divided by 72 gives you 70 ml, that becomes the answer. Is the same question, doctor? No, this is not the same question. What was there? Is it more complicated? Maybe they might have given lot of unnecessary terms. His respiratory rate is so much, urine output is so much, sweat rate is, mechanical sweat rate is that much. But ultimately, options are the same and values 5 and 7. Bas, khatam. They are out of screen. Okay. Yeah, screen is on. Question is also same, says Vijay. Ultimate philosophy of question is same. What is the special feature of pulmonary system compared to that of systemic circulation? This is a very standard old question. We discussed it in last year's AIMS or PGI paper. So doctor, it is a low pressure zone. Systolic BP in systemic circulation is 120. Pulmonary circulation is only 25 to 30. And it is a high compliance system. It can accommodate a lot. And it has a high flow system. It basically carries the same amount of blood which systemic circulation is carrying, pulmonary system. So low pressure, high flow, high compliance system is what I want to underscore to all of you. Right, doctor? Now, where are the fenestrated capillaries? Another standard Murali Muttaidra, what is that? What ball it is? Dusra. Murali Dharan's Dusra ke jaise standard spin. You have to answer. There is no way. What are the different types of capillaries, doctor? You have, answer is intestine me. You have fenestrated. Fenestrated capillaries are the feature of endocrine gland, intestines, pancreas and glomeruli, wherever filtration is required, absorption is required, reabsorption happens. Continuous are the ones where you require little tightness. So typically you are having a skeletal muscle, fingers, gonads and skin, there you have tight junctions. And you have sinusoidal type of capillaries is the third type. And they are basically discontinuous. And where do you find sinusoidal type, doctor? Bone marrow, lymph nodes and adrenal gland. So this is how capillaries classification. Once more, if this question comes in the next entrance, at least today's evening investment of time is worth.